everybody out there in local food college land. I'm Greg Swazer. I'll be hosting tonight's Local Food College. We are the University of Minnesota Extension, putting on the Local Foods College. This is the seventh year of the Local Foods College. The program comes to you from the University of Minnesota Extension. Linda Kingery and the Northwest Regional Sustainable Development Partnership is the lead organizer of this event. And we have collaborators from Extension from across the state. Local Foods College is 5 weeks long. If you're just joining us for the first time, this is the third week the Local Food College is doing Deep Runner Greenhouse this time. You'll get the chance to find out what the next two are if you're interested in participating. It's a great opportunity to get to learn about some good stuff without having to pay a lot or drive far away. So why do we do Local Foods College? We do it to support farmers in our local food system and gardeners and people who want to produce food for themselves. And this online format really allows us to reach a pretty wide geography. We started off just doing this in the Northwest region 7 years ago, and it's grown, and now we get people from all over the country, occasionally from other countries as well. So it's been a pretty good deal. Tonight's plan, ask questions in the chat box way down here on the bottom right of your screen. You and any of your dogs are muted, except Carol's dogs are not muted. Sorry, Carol. Sessions will be recorded and posted again, as I just said, in the Local Foods College website, in addition to the Regional Partnerships YouTube page, or maybe just the Local Foods College website, not sure. Please have patience with this technology as we try to figure out how to make it work. It's working pretty good so far. You will be emailed a link when you're done to evaluate this session, so please complete it. The session will last 1 hour. We might go a little bit over time to let you answer some questions if there are any questions left remaining, but it'll be about an hour. And this is Carol Ford. Carol Ford is the Deep Winter Greenhouse Program Coordinator with the University of Minnesota Extension's Regional Partnerships. Ford owns and operates the Garden Goddess Enterprises, where she produces crops all winter long in her Deep Winter Greenhouse. And now it's time to switch to your slides, Carol, and now you can take it away.
So let's get started. Tonight we're going to be talking about Deep Winter Greenhouses. What they are and what they can do in Minnesota, which is a lot, actually. The one that you're looking at right now with this starting slide is the new prototype that we've designed through the Regional Sustainable Development Partnership. And the partnerships exist in outer Minnesota. There's five of them. And in each one of those regions, we built or are building one of these greenhouses. And they're being owned privately, either by farmers or by nonprofits. And in return for some support from us in when they build them, the partnerships are allowed to do research in them for 3 years, which is pretty exciting because we get to see how we get to answer different questions that we have about improving either the efficiency of the greenhouse or the proficiency of it as far as production goes. So we're doing some tests in them now, and it's a fun thing. Now I want to make sure that I've got my view set so I can see what's coming up next. Okay, here we go. So this is my Deep Winter Greenhouse, and I should say too, as we go along, if you've got questions, go ahead and send them in the chat to Greg. We're going to kind of play this by ear. He's either going to interrupt me as we go if it's a good time to answer it. We're talking first about design and then about production. So there's kind of a natural break there. We can maybe get caught up on questions and we'll just see how we roll. Because usually, you know, it's hard to tell with you all as far as where you're at with your knowledge on these greenhouses. So I would say I'm going to try out the thing that Anna suggested to me. You know, you've got the green check and the red X. So if you feel like you're fairly familiar with Deep Winter Greenhouses, go with the green check. And if you're pretty darn new to it and just coming in to see what you can find out, hit that red X and we'll see what happens. This is supposed to be your interactive moment. Go for it. Let's see what we get. Lots of checks. Okay, good. We'll start from the basics. What you're looking at right here is my greenhouse, which is, I could throw a rock and hit it right now because I'm in my dining room. This one was built 14 years ago, and it was really one of the first ones in the state. So we, my late husband and I had to design this thing based on what we could read about regarding basic passive solar design principles. The only way that it makes sense in Minnesota to grow food in a greenhouse is to do it with as small a carbon footprint as you can. And by using passive solar design, we're able to use very little backup heat in them. And I can attest after many weird winters that it really does work. And we're going to run through what those principles are. And I'm going to start from the bottom up because that's really where the key is. In this greenhouse, it's very different from other traditional greenhouses or hoop houses. It has an insulated foundation that goes below the frost line. And in my case, mine was built off the back of my garage. So it's 16 feet deep by 22 feet long. And you can see we're just doing basic masonry here. There's a lot of different ways you can approach this foundation, but it's critical to have, because what you're basically creating is a heat tank instead of a heat sink. Normally, if you were going to be heating up the area below the greenhouse, which is what this is doing, if you didn't have that protection, all that heat that you would be gaining would just drain out into the cold soil around it. So, and in addition to that, you can see in the next one that there's also on the inside of that cement, like if you look here, there's the edge of the cement, and inside of that is stiff blue foam, and that gets trimmed down, you know, later on to the edge, the top edge of the brick. But you can see here, that doesn't really look like 4 feet, but it is. We went down that far, and I'm glad we did. And if you're up farther north, you're probably going to need to go maybe deeper still. You just want to make sure that the frost doesn't get in there and start sucking the heat out. So in addition to all of that, let's see, let's go back here because I may have forgotten. Yeah, I was so I was so impressed with my greenhouse, I forgot to say that another really critical part of this passive solar design is having that structure built facing straight south and having no obstructions at all. If you've got, like for me, I had to cut down a couple of trees. But you know, there's so little light energy for us in the wintertime. You've got to capture all of it. And that means you got to go for that southern exposure and make sure there aren't any trees or anything else that even a neighbor's yard, you know, something in your neighbor's yard that's going to shade it, because you need it all. Now, in that hole that we dug, we laid down gravel, and that's really like river rock. It's a size, about the size of your fist or a little smaller. And on that is, what you can see here, is perforated drainage tile. And it runs all over in, you know, back and forth in that rock bed. And here you can see that perforated drainage tile is attached to these PVC pipes here and here. Now those are going to run up to the peak of the greenhouse because, as we know, heat rises. And then there are also exhaust pipes. There's one here, you can't see it, but there's also another one over here. So that the air that's collected at the top, we'll see the whole greenhouse soon, but just so you know, it when it gets to a certain temperature in the greenhouse, there are sensors in the pipe that turn on and there are fans that kick in. And they draw that hot air down through this pipe into the PVC pipe. And that has slots in it so that the air can escape. And this pipe is also covered. It comes up, you know, it's going to be covered with gravel as well. So as that air comes through this pipe, it starts to heat up the rock around it. And gradually, that heat then makes its way here, and these are cap. There's a cap on this that has holes in it, so that's where the air releases. And this pipe is not directly connected to the PVC because you don't want the air moving too quickly. If it was connected to the pipe, it would just be, you know, moving around and go straight out. This way it has a chance to percolate around in that rock, so the rock can absorb as much of that heat as possible. And once that's all put together, it ends up with we used, if you're familiar with Remay or with floating row cover, we had some leftover and we laid that down after the rock covered the pipe so that the soil above wouldn't sift down through it. So this is what it looks like once the black dirt's on top. These again are the two pipes that are connected to the perforated drainage tile, and this is the escape pipe here, and there's another one over here where you can't see it. And now it's getting ready to become a full-fledged greenhouse. So one of the other features, and so this really, this whole setup here with how you have a space to gather and hang on to the heat that you get during the day, we decided to go with the thermal mass being below the structure because it doesn't take up room in the structure. This is a pretty precious space, and you want to be able to use every inch of it that you can for production. So by having the thermal mass underneath, we free up space in the greenhouse for more stuff to grow. And then the other thing is anywhere that's not collecting that light energy of the walls in there, you heavily insulate them. You don't need to have, the front of the greenhouse is a twin wall polycarbonate. It makes no sense to have that on the north side, which is what this picture shows, to have the poly there because it's not gaining enough light to compensate for the fact that, you know, the polycarbonate's what, like a 2.5 R value, and this stuff that we're putting in here was what, 18 or something like that. It's that pink foam or the pink, you know, fluffy stuff. And since then, I have talked to other design people who think that maybe the pink insulation is not a great idea because there's a chance if that membrane gets compromised that you can end up with mold in the insulation. And I do know one grower who had that happen. I have not. If I had thought that through, I probably would have agreed with those design guys. So I would suggest in going forward to use something that isn't going to give you that potential problem, because if you've got mold behind your walls, you're looking at a big, ugly job, and nobody needs that. This is what she looks like framed up. In my case, my husband Chuck and I decided to leave the front ends of the, this is the east wall, and over back in here is the west wall. We went ahead and polycarbed this front area here, thinking that we would get some good, if it didn't give us so much in the way of heat energy, that it would give the plant some extra light. And at this point, I would have to say that I really wish now that we had just framed it in solid. And I will probably do that at some point when I need to replace that poly on the sides. Because it, although, you know, maybe the east side I would leave open because I do get pretty good light in the morning on the east side. So, but I would definitely, the west one is getting hit with the wind more. So I would at least close that one in totally. But this is how it looks when it's starting to look like something. For me, because I don't conceptualize these things very well, this is when it started actually looking real to me. And again, that's how it looks at the end. And it, so it also here is the west wall again, and that has an intake shutter on it. And on the east wall is where the exhaust fan is. And if it's super hot out, that's what I use sometimes to try and draw in a little bit cooler air to tamp that down. When it was first built, also up here, you can see there are vents up there that use those automatic, you know, wax open and release vents. We lost that pretty quickly because on the Minnesota prairie, the winds can grab those suckers and just bang them around. And we finally just took them off and roofed over that section because they were more harm than good on windy days. This is what it looks like here again. Here was that pipe, and it's connected to the stove pipe that goes up to the peak. This is on the east side, so that's the exhaust fan there. And there's a backup propane heater, a little guy, that only kicks in when it gets down below 40 degrees in there. This is a cool greenhouse, and so we choose plants that accommodate that because it also requires less propane or backup heat or anything to make it happy. And I've also found that in a cool greenhouse, you have less problems with disease and pests. It's when you have warm soil and warm air, you're just going to have more of those kinds of problems. And this is on the side that is on the west. Same, you know, pipe system coming up and down. And that here is where we can bring in some cool air. Normally, I don't do that in the dead of winter because that air is just too cold. I will use the door that goes into the garage, which has been, that half has been converted into my packing shed. And I will use that somewhat mitigated air if I'm cooling down the greenhouse. And here we go. And so now what I want to show you is some of the other greenhouses that have been built. The Regional Sustainable Development Partnership got a grant to look at ways to improve the design that Chuck and I came up with. And so we got some pretty terrific people working on that in areas of, you know, sustainable passive solar engineering. And this, and the guy that did that, Dan Handeen, came up with this design. And this one was built near Finland, Minnesota. It's a beauty, and she's growing food for people right now. He came up with a very different approach to getting the hot air down into the rock. And I know we got to go quickly, but I want to show you what that looks like because it is very different. You can see, for starters, that there isn't any perforated drainage tile weaving through the system. What Dan decided to do is to use this. This is also that kind of pipe. And where the air is being drawn in is actually here. And Dan's reasoning on that is because cold air is actually more substantive. It's a lot easier to move cold air than it is to push the hot air in. So he's got his fan right there where my pointer is, and it's sucking air. And so that creates a vacuum in the rock that helps the hot air above get drawn into this pipe system that comes down from the back and just runs across the back of the rock bed and allows the air to just kind of move freely through there until it gets sucked in through here and out right up through. This is PVC pipe that has holes in it that allows that air to move through. I think that's pretty cool. And we have three greenhouses right now that have been built with that design that are in operation. And we're going to be doing a lot of testing to find out what's going on in that rock bed. They're growing just fine. The one down in Medelia is full of healthy, happy plants. So it's not killing them. And pretty soon we'll find out, you know, how the two compare, which is a great thing to have the university working on that with us. And then I think next I'm starting in with the production stuff. So.
Hello, Carol.
Yeah, give me some questions, Greg.
All right, there's a couple of questions here. And everyone else, go down and put some questions in the chat if you have them, and I'll go read them to Carol here. Where is your greenhouse, first of all?
Oh, sorry. My greenhouse is in Milan, Minnesota, population 372. I'm out in west central Minnesota, so if you know, well, basically I'm a straight shot across the state from the Twin Cities, or, you know, like 40 miles straight west of Wilmer, not too far from the Dakota border. So I am in solid prairie, and the wind blows like crazy. And one of the reasons I wanted to find a solution to growing in the wintertime that wasn't a hoop house is because they can get damaged pretty easily in our windstorms. And the I even if it's a double sheet of the polyfilm on them, there comes a point when the ground is going to freeze. And to keep those things warm enough for plants can cost you a lot in propane. My greenhouse runs under $200 of propane a season, not a month or a week. That's a lot less than you have to put into a hoop house, even in the spring. So this is definitely a way to cross that, you know, sort of fill in that hole in the middle of winter. And we'll talk about how it's also kind of different production-wise. But yeah, that's where I am. That's a long answer. What's the next one?
All right. What is the recommended pitch of the roof for the Minnesota climate?
Well, it, you know, we're a long state, so that can vary a little bit. But basically what you want to do is know what the angle of the sun is wherever you live at the deepest part of winter, so right around solstice. As we all know, the sun is getting lower on the horizon that time, and you want the pitch of the greenhouse to hit exactly with wherever the sun is coming from. And that's going to depend on where you live. So you have to check that out. And what we ended up doing with my greenhouse, that's why the pitch on mine looks different. There's mine. And here's the one that's in Finland. The difference in the angle is not just how far south or north we are. It's also because when we were building ours, this first one, we were using local carpentry guys, and he basically begged us to go with a 45-degree angle because it was easier to build. And we decided to do that. It saved us some money. These are all, you know, like if you're ever building one of these things, these are all the kinds of questions that you're going to be asking yourself and making choices on, and that's the choice we made at the time. I also thought I would have more workable growing space if I didn't have a slant like that, you know, but because it's almost straight up there. So I think I was incorrect on that. And if I was going to build another one, I would probably go more with, you know, this kind of model because it does catch more of that direct sun energy that way. I hope. And if after I've talked an answer to any questions, if you've got another one or you don't think I got your point, just send another thing to Greg and we'll get it. Any others for now, Greg? Greg? Did you forget how to unmute, Greg? I thought you said you had another one. I'm hoping.
There we go. Hi, 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 hi. Yeah, I was muted.
Okay. Yep.
With the second suction system, how do you ensure the air is coming in through these upper tubes? Won't a lot of the air be sucked in through the floor?
Sucked in through the floor.
I think the floor is solid here, so I think there's...
Yeah. And even if it wasn't, you know, you've got either flooring or soil above the rock. The rock is not, you know, bare on top. It's covered by something. And some of them, they put, like, floors in. In my case, I've got... black dirt that's been packed down enough, and in my case it does percolate up through my raised beds, but because I have raised beds, these designs don't. So for me, it adds some warmth to the soil in my raised beds, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. But yeah, with their system, not an issue because the rock is covered. I hope that's clear now. Any
okay,
others, Craig?
Yep. Any other thermal mass objects like barrels, et cetera?
Well, if you're doing barrels, you know, they're going to be probably along the north wall of your greenhouse. And I didn't want to do that because I didn't want to give up growing space myself. And I also thought that this might be, might actually produce a bigger amount of thermal mass than the water. And I wouldn't have to worry about, you know, water leaks if something went wrong, if there was a freeze up in the greenhouse with the, you know, with those water tanks freeze. I was just looking for what we hoped would be the simplest, most effective system. Those other ones work, and you can also, you know, I've seen where they do like a rock wall on the back, where it's almost like a fence, and then you've got rock piled into that so the sun can hit it and let it radiate back. The best thing to do is just do what we did and read everything that you could possibly get your hands on from the 70s about passive solar design. Or, you know, talk to the people like Dan Handeen at the university about things that they've looked into. I think one of the things they're so excited about with this is that they get to apply some of these principles that they've read about in a very practical sort of sense. And Dan was good with the rock bed. He seemed to think that that was the way to go as well. So I'm glad we got that part right. But I do see that his design could be an improvement on it for efficiency. And we do have one greenhouse that we're building that's going to have all kinds of sensors down in the rock bed. So we'll finally be able to really get, you know, like accurate data on what's going on down there. The other greenhouses have a few here, a few there, just to make sure that it's kind of working. But with that many sensored system, we're gonna get some really interesting data. And I'm in a year or two, we're gonna have a lot more to talk about that. It's so hard to wait. Okay, any more, Dan?
Yep, there's a couple here. Let's see. How hot does it get in the summertime? Where are all of the test greenhouses located? And that's what we have so far.
Okay. In the summertime, you know, my greenhouse was built to collect as much heat as possible. So in the summertime, that works too well. My first couple years, I tried growing stuff in there in the summer that would love heat, like watermelons and hot peppers, and it gets so hot, they drop their blossoms. So I kind of gave up on trying to grow in the summer. We have been looking at ways to kind of extend the growing season in the greenhouse, kind of like you do with hoop houses, in that, you know, for myself in the spring, I make some nice money by starting outdoor garden transplants. And I do this, I collect pots from like garage sales, and I start annual flowers and I start herbs, and I pot them up in these things to sell at a couple of local events in the spring. And the thing that just makes an obnoxious amount of money for me is I start different kinds of herbs, and I'll put 2, 3, 4 different kinds in a pot, depending on the size. And I make these cute little signs that say Cabin Herb Garden. And I sell them at outdoor things in the spring, and they get gobbled up. And I get just, you know, an unfair amount of money for them. But it pays for my seed for the next season, so I do it. And some things that we've talked about doing, looking at, is doing solar dehydration of stuff like tomatoes and maybe even curing some things like onions or squash. My concern about doing that in the fall is you're running a risk when you bring that stuff in, it's probably still got some soil on it. And you could bring in pests, or you could even bring in a soil pathogen that way. I would not do it. It's every grower's, you know, privilege to make their own call on that. I constantly warn people about keeping the outdoors and the greenhouse world separate. So I have like separate tools for my greenhouse that never go outside. My garden stuff never comes in the greenhouse. It's just an extra precaution, because in this greenhouse, it's very much a contained space. And if you end up with a problem, you don't have any of those natural balances to help you take care of it. I try to keep it pretty separate in that way. Things can go out from there, like the things that I grow to sell, but I don't bring so much in. And the other thing that I do in the summer that I think is important for the health of the greenhouse, because I have raised beds, is that I do solarization, where I close it down in the summer for 6 to 8 weeks and get the temperature, allow the temperature to go up like to 160 degrees or something like that. And that helps kill anything that might be in there, including any pests that might be in there. And then when I come back in the fall, I reintroduce the beneficials in the soil and add compost and things like that. It's a precaution, but you know, if you get problems in there, it's not, it's such an intense growing space. You'll see some pictures soon that show that, and it's not easy to control. And the places where we've got these prototype greenhouses, we're calling them the 2.0s. We've got one in Finland. We've got one in Bemidji where the food shelf is. We've got one down in sort of south central Minnesota near New Ulm and Medelia at a farm there. And we've got one in, that's going to be built soon in Brainerd. And Greg, where, what is the other one close to town-wise? I don't remember.
Lake City.
Lake City.
Lake City is on the Brainerd one.
Yeah. And when we've had these things open up, the three that have opened up so far, we publicize in that area and also on the Deep Winter Greenhouse Facebook page that we've got and the partnerships site with Extension. We start off with an open house at them, so people in the area or people will, who want to come see it. We have a nice event of, in an afternoon and people can come around. We have a couple of talks. Dan's usually there to explain his design and give folks a chance in the area to see that this thing is going on, to get them excited about it. And then a little while after that, I come back in and do a workshop. It's a smaller thing people sign up for. And it gives them an opportunity to hear about some of the stuff I'll go over briefly here as far as the production goes. And we'll be continuing to do that kind of thing. We're doing research in them now. It's pretty exciting. I love getting answers to those questions that farmers need. This is one of the really wonderful parts about the partnership in my mind is they go grassroots up. They don't have somebody coming in and telling you how to do it. They allow people to say what they want to do and then they help them. And that's what we're doing with this research, which is terrific.
What is the ideal cover for the floor of the greenhouse or for the,
for
the base of the river rack?
Yeah, wait a minute. Say that again.
Well, it says, what is the ideal cover for the base of the river rock? I think that they mean the floor of the greenhouse.
Oh, well, it kind of depends on what you want to do. In the, well, here, I'll show you quick. This is what it looks like in my greenhouse. And so to maximize the growing space, we grow vertically as well as horizontally. So you can see down here, I've got raised beds. This stuff that I'm pointing at now is purple pak choi. This is Chinese cabbage. And then above that, we have these planters that are made out of sections of just plastic rain gutter with end caps on them and holes drilled in the bottom, and they're hanging from harnesses made out of clothesline. And so it basically doubles our growing capacity by doing that. So if you want to be, and so down in the raised beds is where I put the stuff that needs a little more root space than you can get in those planters. So in the planters, it's all salad greens, all different kinds. Like I got three dozen different varieties that get planted through the winter. And down in the raised beds, it's the bigger stuff like the Chinese cabbage, pak choi, kale, collards, chard grows really well in there, broccoli rabe, stuff like that. Now, in the newer greenhouses, because of the design and the flooring, they're doing just greens, but they're also experimenting with, like, I never wanted to do microgreens because I just thought, you know, I think my customers wanted salad greens, and so that's what I grow. But for the ones that have been marketing those microgreens, it sounds like they're really liking it, and it's going really well for them. So I think it's kind of a double thing of what you want to grow and what your market wants to buy that would be part of your exploration about building one of these things, to have a sense for how you want yours set up. And Dan could probably help anybody that would want to be using his design, but also doing some kind of floor thing. I mean, I've seen some of the greenhouse people even grow some of the bigger stuff like the pak choi in soil bags that they just cut the holes for and grow them out of the soil bag. And when they're done, it goes in the compost and you do another one. So there's a lot of ways to go about it. And if you get a chance, I know we're just rushing through stuff here, but if you get a chance to come to you know, one of our workshops, or, you know, I also do presentations at different conferences and stuff. You can even get online, and I'll show you the resource to get there. The Facebook group that we have for the Deep Winter Greenhouse Growers, and that's a super great place when you're starting to think about doing this to ask all kinds of questions, not just to me, but to other people who've either been looking into it and or growing or both. So there will be ways that you can access information while you're looking at the setup that you want to do so that it fits your dream, because these things are flexible. It doesn't have to be done just one way.
All right, got a couple of questions here. One real quick I'll answer here is, when is the one in Brainerd being built? The one, it'll be near Brainerd. It'll be Grandpa G's farm located in Pillager, just about, 15 minutes west of Brainerd. They're going to start building as soon as the ground is thawed, and I suspect we'll be doing an open house up there before, or a workshop, I think, before they're done covering it up so people get to see the ground and see the rock.
Oh, cool. That's a good idea.
So maybe April or May, I'm guessing, maybe June around then. Cool. Do we know when the workshop in Bemidji will be held? The workshop in Bemidji has been held already. I think we have a new grant, a SARE grant, that will allow us to do another round of workshops next year, and what will it be, 2019 by then, and there's a good chance we'll probably do one up in Bemidji. I think we might do one up in Bemidji at that point. Let's see. Can you build a deep winter greenhouse using a high tunnel? Suggestions for a larger scale?
We're going to start exploring what a larger scale greenhouse might look like. There are ways that you can try to make a hoop house more passive solar. The problem you're always going to have, well, not exactly, though. Let me back up on that. You know, you can put a foundation around a high tunnel. I've seen it done at the food farm near Renshaw, Minnesota. What they actually did was they took that stiff insulation foam and they put it horizontally out from the greenhouse edge and down a few inches. And their purpose in that was to retard the inevitable frost from creeping in, because of way up where they are, they need that to be able to get a good harvest of tomatoes. So it keeps their hoop house productive longer. But, you know, it's basically a plastic bubble, you know, a hoop house. And it's just not going to retain the heat like a structure like this does. You can always push the envelope as far as season extension goes. But in a hoop house, you're generally, the planting idea is that you're in there in the fall to get the crop to almost harvest size before it gets super cold. And then the plants are going to go into stasis because they can't do their chemistry that they need to do to be a growing plant when the soil's that cold. They can't access the nutrients, so they just sit there asleep. They can still be harvested, and you can, you know, as long as they aren't frozen when you harvest them, you know, you put row cover over them, or it's a warm day, you can get in there and do that. But, you know, it's not like in this greenhouse. You can see from the picture that's in front of you, this is a system that's constantly growing. And so in these planters, you're going to have, you know, 3 to 5 cuttings off of it, and then you empty it out and you replant. So I am, and this is beautiful if you're a farmer and you love to grow, because I'm planting new stuff every week in the wintertime. And I go in there when it's minus 20 and sunny outside, like a few days ago, and it's 80 degrees in that greenhouse. So it's not cold in there. It will be if it's a cloudy day. It gets down to 50, you know, but that's ideal for this kind of, you know, we're using these cool weather crops. So you're not going to do fruiting crops because the day length is too short. You just can't do it. But as it turns out, people love getting these fresh greens in the middle of winter. And they taste amazing because they're so happy. They're not getting, you know, hard rained on. They're not getting beat up by the wind. They're not being bothered by those nasty flea beetles and all the rest of it. They're just they're a premium crop. And you can see that. You'll see some more of them. Should we move on into the production stuff?
Yeah. I think there are a couple questions. I think what we'll do is we'll do the rest of this, and then we'll spend some time trying to get through the rest of the questions. So if you have some questions, write them in here. We'll bank them up, and then we'll address it in the end.
Okay. So here's another picture of what the greenhouse looks like. It's hard to get very many people in there when it's in full production, but you can see that it's pretty intensive growing. And in a little minute, I'm going to show you how we can do it even more intensively. Actually, here it comes. One of the things that is so beautiful about having more people growing and thinking about how to improve this is that they've come up with ways to get even more planters in there. And this is a photo in the Medelia new 2.0 greenhouse. And you can see in this section here is where we're doing the university research. So these planters are pretty close together, but they haven't even germinated yet there. You can see over here, they've built their own framework for, you know, where they put their planters. And here is the second row, and down here is the third row. So they're kind of building a tiered thing where, you know, the first row is right up, you know, near where the wall is. And then the next one is back a little bit from it so that it can get, you know, the light can get to the lower one. And then the one up here is the farthest back. So that's the system they use. And when we put this in, this is just a metal framework of shelving because we had to do, you know, what was it, 27, Greg, that had to get planted in each place at once. And like in my greenhouse, when I put mine back here, you can see where they've got their propagation mats, and they put their planters there to help the plants get a faster start. Generally in the greenhouse in the wintertime, you can get germination from 3 to 5 days. And I noted, like with the ones up here that weren't on heat, it took them over a week to germinate. So again, you know, you're making, and you don't normally have to put 27 out at a time either, but it's a way of, you know, once you understand how things flow in here, then people start putting their brains to how can we do this better, more efficiently, get more production in there without compromising the health of the plants. And that's the kind of stuff that we're experimenting on now. So you don't have to break the bank figuring it out for yourself. The university is going to be doing some of that for us, which is pretty awesome. This is a better look at it from whoever scrambled up there to take this top picture. But yeah, so you can see the university stuff here. Here's some more of her stuff growing. I don't really see a picture of her microgreens here, but she grows those in the planters as well. And that's a one-cut deal. This stuff, all of these things, they'll be cut multiple times before they're replaced by new ones. I've already talked about, isn't this nice mustard? This is a red giant mustard, beautiful. The other nice thing about growing in the winter with the cool crops is that some of these crops that you tend to think of as being pretty strong, like arugula or mustards, because this is a cool environment and it's really a gentle place for them, they're much milder, and they're being cut as greens. Like mine, I cut around 4 inches or so. These I let get a little bit bigger for a different event, but they're fork ready and they're so tender. They're just so great. I just love them. And here's another example of how we try to get as much in as possible. This is my raised bed. This is young Chinese cabbage. They get planted pretty close together because by the time they're getting up to their harvest size, you can't see the ground anymore. And I choose varieties in these raised beds that are meant to be harvested at a younger size. They look like a fully complete plant at a younger size. This one's called Minuet. And that way people can get 3 small tender ones instead of 1 great big one. That I based on what I knew that my CSA members wanted. So those were the choices that I made as far as what I grew and how I grew it. And what do we got next? We did that one. Oh, yeah, this is a wonderful little story plant. This is a broccoli rob. When I first started out, this is again about getting the most out of the space. I liked growing broccoli in there because it's the most magnificent broccoli you'll ever eat in your life. It's so tender, you don't have to cook it, but it's almost like it was. I mean, it's just, and there's never been a green worm on it. And I used a variety called DeSico, which is an Italian broccoli that branches. You don't get one great big head. You just get all those branches you get sometimes in the summer if you cut the big head off and don't take the plant out. You only get those side ones. That's all this one does. So you pick them. And people like that size of a broccoli, too. You don't have to cut it up. They're all ready to go to do whatever. So it was nice in that respect. But you can see how much space it takes up. And space is precious in there. So this one is actually the broccoli rabe, and you eat the whole plant with this bad boy. So I much prefer that and you could probably eat actually the broccoli leaves of the broccoli, but it wasn't grown to do that. This one, the leaves are more tender and flavorful, I think, because I tried it. And here you can see just and one of the nice things I like to point out is any kind of red variety of a crop that you have gets super red in the wintertime. And I'll show you a pak choy that's amazing that way too. But there are lots of different varieties. And every week when I cut what I harvest, it's different every week. People love that. So like these guys are nowhere near ready to get harvested. But this is a red Russian kale, and it is. And this one's called tatsoi. This one is minutina. This is bull's blood beets. It's a variety that's meant to be cut for the leaves, not the little beets are insignificant. But these leaves in a salad mix pop out like jewels. They're so beautiful. And they have a beady flavor, so they're really nice. You get to almost be a gourmet when you're doing your cutting to put together a salad for people that they're really going to enjoy. This one's another broccoli rabe that's about to get harvested. So you can see how big they get, and that's why I plant them along the south wall there so they can get plenty of sun without crowding out other stuff. I should keep moving here, although they are pretty. Here's that pak choy. I'm telling you, that stuff's hard to cut. It's so beautiful. And it's this color that you see in the veins is the color of the bottom of the leaves. You can see the stems too. And the whole thing's edible. The stems are really tender. And people just love getting a product like this every week in the wintertime. You can't beat it. So the planting schedule I'll do really fast. I already started talking about this a little bit, but plants respond differently to the beginning of winter when the days are diminishing, and the middle of winter when the days are the shortest, and then the end of winter when the daylight is starting to expand. And the real trick for maximum productivity in these spaces is to figure out which plants do best in each of those seasons. This is what I'm showing here is planters on my germination mats, and these are all midwinter ones because I see the Tokyo Bacana there, and that one, this one is a lighter, it's actually a brassica, which is weird because it looks like a lettuce and it grows better than anything else in the middle of winter. That thing, I mean, you can get 5 cuttings off it in the middle of winter, so it's, once you find something like that, it's a total champion. And I'm going to blast past some of this explanation of that stuff because it's, we got to keep going. These are nice. This is a, again, it's showing how, this is a salad mix. It's called Wildfire. It's from Johnny's Seed Catalog. And it's got a lot of nice reds in it. They really pop out in the wintertime. This one is red-veined sorrel, and it has a nice lemony flavor to it. It grows slowly, though. So it's one that I sometimes compromise productivity for, just because it's so gorgeous in the mix. Oh, God. People love, I mean, you know, the visual quality of it is part of what makes this a premium product. This one is called Scarlet Frills. It's a mustard. And having that in your salad just kind of, I don't know, it makes my day. And I want to come to this so that everybody gets a chance to write this down, that these are the key, really, to me, sources that you can use to get more information about deep winter greenhouses and production. The first one is our website that has every bit of research or sources that we've collected so far. It even has the blueprint for the 2.0. And it's free. It's all accessible for anyone, the public, for free. The next one is how you get to our Facebook group. You do have to ask to join, but unless you're an ex-murderer, I'll probably let you in. In fact, we will. And the last one, if you need to get a hold of me for anything, this is my email address and my phone number. So that ought to, and please, if you need some help, let me know. I will do my darndest to get you what you need, because it's really important to me, if someone has a passion for this, that they get the opportunity to try it out, because producing food like this for my neighbors has changed my life in a wonderful way. And helping other people do it has as well, because I, of course, got that delightful realization as an educator that if you're paying attention, you're being educated at the same time by the people that you're talking to. And that has happened, not only with people who are just thinking about it, but now I have comrades, you know, all over the state that are doing this too, and they're teaching me a lot while they're doing it. So it's a pretty fun party. I heartily recommend it. So Greg, what other, do we have any more questions? We've still got a little bit of time, it looks like.
We do have some questions. You want me to just get to them?
Yeah, let me put a pretty picture up too, because why look at words and yeah. Look at food.
So are your rows hanging beds parallel to or perpendicular to your south wall?
They are, let's see, let me show one here. This is the south wall. So they're running this way and the south wall is running this way.
That's perpendicular. I'm not sure they have to be perpendicular, but
I didn't want to say the wrong one.
Is there a good resource for the types of plants we can grow in the deep winter greenhouses?
Did we put that list on the site yet?
Yep.
Yeah, we've got a list of them on the site, and it's broken down by the beginning, middle, and end seasons.
Is that site, you just had that on the previous slide, right?
Yeah. Nope, down to the bottom. Here we go. Right there.
Yep. All right. Is there a good reason? Okay. What is the estimated cost today of the size of your greenhouse in Milan?
Well, I built mine for $18,000, and that was soup to nuts. We converted half of the garage into a packing shed, and we did have contractors do most of the construction. So we had a guy come in and dig the hole. We had a mason come in and do the wall. I mean, that part, the bottom part is really critical, because if something's done poorly down there, you're screwed.
This was in, when was it, 2008?
No, I think it was 2000, isn't it 2006?
So that was good.
It was 13 years ago or something. So it would be more now, and what we're finding with the there's really a range as far as how much, and I know people want a solid number, and I hate to disappoint them and give them the, it depends, but it does. It depends on what size you decide to go with, mine or larger, don't go smaller. It's harder to maintain a steady temperature in a smaller greenhouse than it is in a big one, because you got more airspace to handle the change. But we don't know how big they can be yet. We're still kind of looking into that. But it's going to depend on things like, do you already have existing infrastructure-ish stuff? Like, is there water on the site that you want to use? Are you going to have to take trees down? What are you going to do about your wastewater if that's got to get connected to some kind of sewer system or something like I did? If you've got adequate electricity there. All of those things, you know, can, if you've got them, save you money. If you don't, you got to have them. I do know one deep winter greenhouse grower who doesn't have water actually in her greenhouse, but she has to bring water in to fill up a 55-gallon container for it. So if you're willing to do a lot of schlepping at the beginning, you can always maybe get water in there later to help. And of course, if you have a brother-in-law with a bobcat and knows how to use it, swell. And if you have some basic carpentry skills and can frame it up yourself with some friends, swell. If you're part of a nonprofit organization, You can maybe get volunteers to help cut down the price on some of this stuff. So yeah, I mean, we've had greenhouses built for 6,000 to, what was the big one, Greg?
68,000. The prototypes went from, I think, 22 to 68 to build the exact same prototype in all three greenhouses. The 22 one didn't have water in it, at least not yet, but that's not, I think, the cheapest. The reason it was cheaper wasn't that, it was that a lot of the labor was volunteered. So a lot of farmers will be able to do that, not all of them. The middle two, so one was 68,000 and one was 38,000, all labor contracted in both of them. They were both identical. It's unsure exactly why. There's just more expensive labor costs in the North Shore and higher delivery costs, things like that. So if you're remote, those delivery costs play into it. We are putting together a deep winter greenhouse, a DIY deep winter greenhouse manual, though, that will help people understand how to cut costs and do a little bit better than the ones that we've got. If cost is I mean, that's a big issue. So we're going to try to address that in the future too. More questions? What are you using on the self side?
Oh, didn't I say that? Oh my God. It's twin wall polycarbonate. And I know in some cases, and that's what it looks like. Let me find another one, get a better shot of it. And that's what's on these new ones too, although I think the one in Finland is triple wall.
Yeah, these are triple wall, but
yeah. You can decide. I mean, you can look online and see what the R value is on the twin wall versus the triple wall. And if it's worth the extra money for the triple wall to do it, we decided that we could go with twin wall, and that's what's on my greenhouse here. You can't see super well, but you can see that it's not perfectly clear. It's a little opaque, and it's got a layer of polycarbonate and a layer of polycarbonate, and in between that is baffling. And so it creates an air pocket and helps not let the heat inside dissipate so quickly. Another thing we're starting to look into, too, is finding some way to have a thermal curtain on these greenhouses. From what Dan has been researching, they do that in China. And I've often thought it would be great if I switch over to having my planters on shelves, then I could have an interior, some kind of thermal curtain, because right now, with all of my stuff hanging off the rafters, there's no way I could do that. And I would never trust trying to do an outdoor thermal curtain where I live because of the winds that we get. I just think they would find their way in and rip it off.
All right. But, so what happens at night when it's 20 below?
Well, there's warmth coming up from below, which helps out. And I have a small backup. I use propane because it was the easiest thing. I have propane heating my house. I've looked at rocket stoves, wondering if that could be a good alternative too. Lots of people are toying with backup. I think it's a really good idea to have even more than one, just because sometimes the power goes out and things can happen. I know that, who is it? Is it Ryan that's got like four different sources of heat for his or some crazy thing like that? It's really up to you. There's a lot of information online about what you can choose. One of the reasons that Chuck and I went the way we did was, again, you know, that some of the choices that we were making about our materials and our design were because we wanted it to be easily replicable, and by somebody that could do it, if they just had some good basic carpentry skills, they could even build it themselves. And yeah, you could maybe go bigger, and we probably will try that. We'll see how far that goes reasonably. But I wanted a size that if somebody like me, who's just like an average Joe with a job, would want to build one of these things, you could afford to. And what we're trying to get now is like some research information that if you need to go to a conventional lender like I did, that you can show them it can be profitable. I had to convince them. Because there was nothing else to go on at the time. But what convinced them was that I had a waiting list of people who wanted to be my CSA members that was four times the size of what I could grow. and they were all willing to pay what I needed to get that thing paid off in 7 years, and I did. And I raised my CSA share membership every year because my small business development counselor kept telling me I wasn't charging enough, which is typical of people starting out a business like this. And no one ever left because of the cost.
So I should note, it's after time now. It's 7:03. We've got a couple more questions left. If anybody wants to jump off, that's fine. If you want to stick around for a couple more questions,
we won't take it personally.
Here we go. Why only greens and why not veggies also?
Greens are veggies, but part of it is because there doesn't seem to be much point in growing you could grow, and I think some people do. You can go ahead and grow root crops if you want. But the thing is root crops are really easy to grow in the summertime, and you can store them. So why would you use your space in your greenhouse to grow something that could be in your cold storage? Unless you build it just to grow for yourself, and then you can grow anything in there that you want. But I haven't tested it. What I do know is that the greens have a high turnover, so you don't have to waste the space growing something all season long. And that way you're constantly putting out more product. I think that's why some of the people are so interested in the microgreens, because you can turn those around even faster. Another one you can do that with is snow pea shoots, or just pea shoots. I use field peas. When they grow, you harvest them when they're about 4 to 6 leaves, and they're really super crispy, tender, juicy, pea-flavored, wonderful in your mouth stuff. So that's really why, because the other stuff, like the fruiting stuff, forget about it. The days are too short. You'd have to add lights, and you could do that if you want to, but you're also going to have to add heat because they don't like this kind of cool environment. One of the big reasons we're doing greens is because they all thrive in minimal temperatures and short days, because that's where when they grow well in the spring and in the fall. We're just having them do it in the winter as well with the right accommodations for what they need temperature-wise.
All right. Any deep winter greenhouses using rocket mass heaters as supplemental heat, such as that in Teal Gardens? I'd like to have a burner in the packing room and pipe heat into a thermal mass germination bench. Wow. Inside the grow space. Any potential problems you might see with that?
Well, I've been thinking about doing the same thing rocket-wise in my greenhouse and having it fed from the packing shed. I think it's a good idea. I haven't built one before, so my concern would be if I screw it up, I could burn down my greenhouse. And one thing that Dan did mention at the last talk that I was with him at is that the polycarb is highly flammable. So if you would ever have a problem with a wood burner in one of these things, it would basically just melt, which is a horrible thing to think about. But I've got a propane heater in mine, and so far so good. I haven't had any problems with it. I like the idea of a rocket stove, especially like you said, the back of my greenhouse, I have 4 of those big barrels that have water in them just for a little added thermal mass. It's not really notable or anything, but I put my germination mats on top of it. I'd love to be able to do that with a rocket stove and maybe not even need, you know, to have the germination mats. But I would think that you'd want to make pretty darn sure you knew what you were doing. It'd have to pass code depending on where you live. Maybe not if you're on a farm. I think it's a practical option. I do.
All right, what's your watering system?
My hands. I mean, I have one of those curly hoses, and it has a water wand on it, and I hand water for a couple of reasons. First of all, you can see it's not huge. It doesn't take me a ton of time, and it's a good opportunity because I'm around all the plants and all the planters to be doing some observations that would, you know, let me know if there's anything wrong going on, if something looks like it's not getting adequate air circulation, or if I ever see like a little moss growing in the raised bed, that tells me there's not enough air movement there and I can adjust fans for it. And I catch that stuff when I'm in there watering. And it also allows me to only water where it's needed, because you don't want it can, the greenhouse is a pretty closed up unit in the middle of winter, so you don't want it to get full of moisture. It's hard to vent that out because it's often too cold. So when you just water when they need it, you're going to have healthier plants, and watering by hand is a good way to do that.
All right. Any of the greenhouses, are any of these projects able to grow greens without having a backup heating system like propane, electric, or wood?
I think I know of one maybe that's in Wisconsin. I think it's Kim's. I don't know that she's got backup. You got to remember, though, if you're doing this commercially, putting your plants at risk like that is pretty risky. Having backup allows you to continue to pursue needing it as little as possible. But I don't know of any who are doing it for profit that would not have backup heat, just in case.
What do you use for growing media and fertilizer, and how often do you fertilize?
Well, you don't want to over-fertilize in the winter, that's for sure, because the plants are drawing up nutrients more slowly because the soil is cooler. My soil in my raised beds is usually, the lowest it goes is 50 degrees, but it's usually around 55, 60, and then into the spring it gets a little warmer than that. I have a soil mix that I mix for my planters, and Greg, am I right that we've got that recipe up on our site yet? Or is
it's
that
not up there, no.
Okay.
But it's in your book. We'll
it's in the
it
book.
There.
I got a book. I can tell you, scramble for a pen if you want to know. I can tell you right off the top of my head. If you need a gallon container, I use ice cream pails. You're going to do three of those of peat moss. And to that, you add half a cup of garden lime, and you mix that all up together. So you got the three of the peat and the half cup of lime mixed together. Then you add in, my fertilizer mix is a mineral fertilizer mix because the minerals release more slowly, and that's what you want in the winter. You don't want a heavy dose into the plants. And that is equal parts blood meal, rock phosphate, and green sand. So a cup of each into this recipe. You can make it up ahead of time and then just put three cups in of the mixture. But if you're not doing that, you know, it's just one of each. And with that, you put in two of those gallon containers of vermiculite. And everybody gets mixed up again. And at the end, you put in 3 gallon containers worth of compost. And that's the mixture, and that's what I use in the planters. In my raised beds, I tend to want to do a soil test before we get into fall to make sure that I'm not putting stuff in there that it doesn't need, because you can get buildups and then you can get problems with the plants. So, I mean, but I always redress with compost. And I was really thinking about that,
mycorrhizal.
Thank you. God, I can never get that right. That is supposed to be really beneficial, is beneficial for the roots of plants. But I recently read that there are some plants that don't take on that symbiotic relationship with this fungus that helps most plants have better intake of the nutrients in the soil. And the ones that don't do that are the brassicas, which is about 90% of what I grow. So it would be a waste of time and money to be dressing the soil that way, since the brassicas don't care. So I'm just going to stick with my really good compost. And when I feel like it, if the soil is looking too heavy, I can add in some more peat and, you know, whatever else. But I do add in some of the mineral fertilizer at the beginning of the season, but I don't redress after I harvest because I don't want to end up with too much in there. It doesn't make plants happy.
All right. Do you just let the water drain onto the floor, and do you have a number of pounds that you produce in a season?
Yeah, I just let it drain in the floor because it just goes down and away. I've never had a problem with excess water like that. I mean, sometimes when you're watering the planters, it'll drip, you know, but it's just water from the soil, so it's not a big deal. And it's because I'm not going crazy like with a conventional greenhouse where it would just be above and just watering the whole space. It's just going right where it's supposed to be, so I don't have a lot of trouble with that. And no, I don't know my weights yet, but I will this year because I'm involved in this research project and we have to weigh when we harvest. But for me, when I was doing CSA, I just was harvesting each week and splitting it 12 ways because that's how many shares I had. So it was, I can show you. Let's see, let me get here, okay. So in one of those bags that you get at the produce section in the grocery store, those sort of opaque produce bags, it was filled, each one was filled anywhere from about this much to about that much. Okay. I have no idea what that weighs.
All right, Carol, if you want to flip back to the other presentation that's up there. I can't do it because I'm not the
Okay. Anymore. Is it this?
yeah, click the next one here. Next slide up. There we go. All right, well, that, unless there's any last second questions here, we'll conclude our local food college with deep winter greenhouse production. So next, the things you can do, fill out the evaluation. Anna has emailed it out to everybody just recently. You can join Local Foods College on Facebook, and to do that, there's the link right here. You'll get connected with the remaining Local Food College presentations and join us next week. You can also tweet. There's another slide, I think, tells us that next week we'll be talking about seed saving with Sherry Breen, Associate Professor of Political Science and affiliated faculty with the Environmental Studies Program at the University of Minnesota Morris. As an environmental political theorist, she studies the relationships between human societies and their physical landscapes, focusing on diverse and conflicting understandings of property and ownership across political systems and culture. She is currently writing on the historic change from human understandings of food and crop seeds as a source of localized collective wealth to a privatized international system of intellectual property rights over plant genetic resources. I feel like I should have had some sort of like music playing as I read all that to you. Some music, but that's it. Thanks. Check out again the website z.umn.edu/localfoodscollege for more info on Local Foods College. And we will see you again next week, the week after, and maybe even next year.